don't know if you heard, 2020 was a little bit of a
little
bit of a strange year. But you know, it's one of those things that I think it also showed our resiliency. So what was IANR able to accomplish during a time really like no other?
Yeah, you could, Troy, wow, 2020, and then I don't know why we all thought that it would just stop on December 31st of 2020, because 2021 has gotten off with some interesting twists as well. But you know, I think 2020, the first thing that hit, of course, about March was the pandemic. It made its way to Nebraska and the U.S. We were watching it kind of from beyond, just kind of creep towards Nebraska, and that created quite a bit of disruption. The next complex challenges I think society faced were the brutal, unnecessary murder of George Floyd. That was difficult, and then just continued Breonna Taylor, and that opened up an awareness that I have not seen in my time on this planet. Back to the days, I would guess, of the 1960s, early 70s around race relations in this country. And so this sense of awareness around systemic racism, systemic privilege, it rekindled in this generation a conversation that we haven't seen for almost 60 years. So that was a second big dynamic. Of course, this was a presidential election year, and so all of the politics that normally happen during that, those three actions, those three events in society, to be honest with you, are enough to challenge any well-orchestrated, well-greased organization. And the university had to weather those dynamics, and we're still weathering those dynamics. So yeah, it was a heavy year. On top of then, down in the trenches, thinking about IANR's three-part mission of teaching and learning, research, innovation, discovery, and then outreach engagement through extension. So the pivot, I guess I would say, that the men and women of IANR, some 2,000 strong across the state, had to make on multiple fronts while dealing with this heavy, these heavy societal and in many cases historic events. So that was a lot. That was a lot on people's shoulders. And I would say that across the board, across every mission area, folks in IANR just dug in deep, rolled up their sleeves, were gritty, were resilient, and did what was necessary to keep themselves safe, the people that they work with and love safe, and knocked it out of the park in a lot of cool ways. It's been tough. I think we've learned a lot of lessons. Maybe we could unpack, talk about some of those, but yeah, it definitely demonstrated the grit and the determination during a historically unprecedented, and it sounds cliche, but literally a historically unprecedented time in our lives. And we were right there. And through it all, the momentum in IANR just kept going, which was really a testimony to the people.
Yeah, and you make a good point, because I think during times like this, it's so important for universities like UNL to be at the forefront of making these types of changes. And you know, whether it's with extension or the teachers or the students, you know, even when all this is going on, we can draw from that, but we also have our jobs to do. So the momentum with what we're doing with IANR, it hasn't stopped at all. If you could talk about some of the big things that happened.
Yeah, one of the things, there's a quote that says, one of the most difficult things as a human to do is to keep two diametrically opposed ideas in your mind at the same time and remain functional. So the faculty, staff, and students of IANR did exactly that. Some specific examples, right? So redialing back to March through May, we were just at the time of calving. We were at the time of planting. So we have our extension educators, 182 of them forward deployed across Nebraska, were engaging with our producers. Our farmers were getting ready for planting. Our ranchers were that spring calve, were just, you know, finishing up spring calving, and some of them were moving towards branding. This was a really tricky time, and our extension professionals had to figure out how best to engage our producers during that time period. our classroom teachers, whether it was graduate students, professional or undergraduate, all pivoted to a hybrid platform. Like within 3 weeks, went to a complete remote engagement strategy. So we had students all over Nebraska who were waking up on the ranch in the morning, doing chores, running cattle, coming back in and engaging with their faculty here remotely. It was really an interesting time when you think about it to put theory in the classroom into practice. Our research platform didn't give up any steam. We were again designated one of the top 20 in the entire universe of ag schools, top 20 U.S. schools of agriculture and natural resources. We were in the top 50 for the fourth consecutive year since I've been tracking, top 50 in the world when you compare everyone that's out there. So whether it's, again, our research, discovery, our teaching and learning, or our the way we engage. Some other examples, you know, we moved from the springtime to working with county fair boards and with county ag societies who are making difficult decisions about what does the county fair look like? Do we have a county fair? We all became armchair epidemiologists. So, you know, we talk differently than we did 9 months ago, 10 months ago. So getting the fairs across the threshold in a way that allowed us to keep the focus on student learning was a big deal. And of course, then we slipped right into harvest season. You know, I guess thankfully we didn't have a weather year like we did an extreme weather year in 2019, so.
And moving on to 2021, I've heard you mention that it's going to be about reconnection and innovation. Yeah. So to you, what does that look like? Maybe we could start with reconnection.
Yeah, so I think about this last year. We're all social beings, right? We're trying to figure this out. We're socially distanced, 10 feet apart. You're all masked up. You and I both had negative COVID tests. So, you know, the world's changed. So reconnecting, it's not that we haven't connected, but I feel, Troy, it's time to get back in as safely as possible, of course, back in contact. It's an odd thing for humans not to be social with one another. So I think we've done a good job. We've learned some lessons, but I think patience is wearing thin. So as far as I'm concerned, keeping the masks moving, socially distancing, enhanced testing, vaccinations are going to be key. And so long as the COVID data allows us, then we'll start moving from a more hybrid remote back to what we're used to. That's that personal engagement. But I will also say that our engagement strategy is never going to look the same. I think Zoom is here to stay. I think that's a good thing. I just don't think anybody wants to do 100% Zoom. I'm looking forward to our field days. We're already talking about what does the summer look like for field days. I only was able to go to one field day. In fact, I think it was the only one that we pulled off. It was at the Panhandle last year. So I think everybody's thinking optimistically, but we know there's a big dose of data when it comes to COVID and the trend numbers. So, you know, knock on wood, things are moving in the right direction. So that's on the extension outreach front, reconnecting. With our students, we've done some incredible cool things, like the Changemaker Scholarship Program. In the office, we talk about the COVID fog. Well, you could talk about the COVID snowstorm here in Nebraska. Good thing about Nebraskans is, by and large, we know how to navigate when you can't see. So we use our other senses, and we're good at that. So if you think about a ship out on the Navy analogy, ship out on the water, you heavy fog, you can't see the shoreline. You can hear, but you can get disoriented. So what do? You slow down. You slow down, you reconnect to the things that are important, you communicate like crazy, and then you work collaboratively and you make progress towards those mile markers. That's exactly what we've done.
I know you love your Navy analogies.
Yeah, sorry.
No, don't apologize. That's awesome. Staying on the topic of reconnection, I think it's going to be big, especially that we focus on the youth of Nebraska. Yeah. Because I was reading an article just yesterday talking about brain drain.
Yeah.
And it's so important, I think, to start early and UNL, IANR is doing that.
Yeah, so Nebraska Extension is a premier, if not the top, definitely in the top three in the country when it comes to youth engagement. And we really think holistically. So we think about the learning child, for example, that focus area and extension is focused on from birth to pre-K. Then our engagement with school districts, all 243 programs. So the 4-H clubs are one vehicle, but our partnership with after school programs, partnerships with schools, really key. And then things like the Northeast Nebraska Agriculture and Natural Resources Education Compact that Dean Tiffany Hang Moss out of the College of Agricultural Sciences and Natural Resources, bringing together partners from Wayne State, from Northeast Community College, NCTA, the two tribal colleges, and then CASNR, thinking about how we, in partnership with those 38 public school districts in the Northeast, how can we work at creating seamless paths for students who are interested or might not even know about things like food and energy and water, and how that impacts society, and then bring a systems approach to that. That's a great example. Or here in Lincoln, not too far from where we're sitting here in the studio, with Lincoln Public School System, with Northeast High School, where we've launched now a focus program on food, energy, water, societal systems. It's called FUSE. And it's an early career and college ready program. So this year, coming up, starting in the fall, all ninth graders will then be receiving information about this integrated food system, this integrated food and water and energy system. And by their junior year, they'll be coming to the East Campus, those who are interested, for early college courses, or maybe they'll want to go on a career track and they'll go to Southeast Community College. So these are partnerships, thinking about youth, really continuing education in creative ways. And all this had its genesis during COVID. So, you know, I think this is just another example of keeping our focus on things that matter, and the youth of Nebraska definitely matter.
And then, of course, I think IANR, maybe we should change the I to innovation, because it's all about, it's all about innovation, but not only innovation of what we're doing throughout the state, what we're doing throughout our colleagues and throughout the university, but also the innovation that is going to be making a mark not only throughout the rest of the country, but the world when it comes to when it comes to ag and education, things like that. And you know, as always the case, IANR at the forefront, and I know that's going to continue into 2021.
Yeah, no question. So innovation in agriculture and food systems is critical, and the special sauce here is the people, both here on campus, across the state, but also our producers, our ranchers, our farmers, our processors. Our bankers, our lenders. Nebraska is home to so many innovators when you think about it. I loved being here for the 150th birthday of Nebraska in 2017, first year I was here. Gave me an insight to the most innovative people I've ever come across. And so when you blend innovative producers and processors and farmers and ranchers with the innovation of something like IANR in this ag natural resource space, it's an amazing partnership that pushes the envelope every day. Sonny Perdue last September, September 4th in fact, when he was Secretary of Agriculture, came here. We gave him a tour of the Innovation Campus, the Nebraska Innovation Campus. We had a panel with the governor, with Congressman Fortenberry, with Ronnie Green and Ted Carter. And the whole focus was around ag innovation. And it was held in Nebraska, importantly, because we are such an important part of the ag innovation platform. So think about Nebraska as an ideas laboratory, if you will, for food, water, ag, energy systems. We move ideas into prototypes. Those prototypes then are tested across our statewide platform, our on-farm research program that is run out of extension is incredible. The proof's in the pudding, but that proving that out in the field allows for greater adoption, both here in America, in Nebraska and beyond, but also around the world. So that's what we do. And I think over the Christmas break, we had an announcement when the omnibus bill was signed into law by President Trump that Congressman Fortenberry the very next morning announced $11.2 million for a new agricultural research service building or facility at the Innovation Campus, focused point blank on innovations in food and ag tech. There's a reason why the United States Congress approved that planning, those planning dollars, and it comes right back down that we are really at the crossroads where North meets South, East meets West, and we are at the center of ag and food innovation. It's an amazing platform for good, no question.
Something always going on, and it's always some great stuff. My final question for you would be, just speak to the farmers who are watching, the producers who are watching. What can you say to them as far as what IANR is doing for them? Mm-hmm. And just kind of just talk to them about, just from the heart, some important things that you think they should know.
Yeah, well, to the farmers and producers, the first thing I would say is thank you, right? So we're the People's University. I say that a lot, but I mean it. This is your land-grant university. We're here for you. The innovation that you you and your resilience, your tenacity, your grit, thank you for being great partners, because candidly, IANR is not an ivory tower. We never have been. We don't aspire to be. We partner with you. To our leaders of our 531 communities, many of those are rural areas, we need to be an asset that you can mobilize, that you can leverage. We need to be part of your solution sets to drive positive things in your communities. And to the youth, to the families that support 4-H and FFA, thank you for your unparalleled support of our youth, and for being committed to growing Nebraska, and thanks for letting us be a part of it. That's what I'd say.
All right, thank you, sir. Always a pleasure to talk to you.
Thanks, Troy.
We really appreciate it.